Hey, everybody. Welcome to Roger and Me, a.k.a. Roger Ebert and Me, a weekly movie review podcast tribute to Siskel and Ebert, hosted by myself, Brett Arnold, and film critic Mark Dujsik of markreviewsmovies.com, where he's been reviewing movies since the year 2000. That's my new one. It's a Conan O'Brien ref. Had to call it out for those who don't understand. I must be understood. I'm not weird. We aim to cover every new theatrical release and every new streaming release every Friday in the format pioneered by Gene Siskel and Roger Ebert. We're an unofficial continuation of At the Movies. We are unsanctioned, but we are the only guide to new releases you'll ever need. We're just trying to do what they did. We're talking about the new movies every week. We're trying to be all-encompassing, but if you're a listener of the show, you know that I've gotten lazier and lazier. But today, while Mark boasts 13 new release movie reviews on his website, we are going to cover 8 this week. 7 of them are new ones for this week, and one of them is a layover from last week that I didn't see, that I mentioned I would probably get to when I went on a date with my wife to go see the Blake Lively starring It Ends With Us. And you might be surprised at my response to it. So we're going to talk about that at the end of the episode, after we talk about all the main event affair, which is stuff that's out this weekend, right now, today. Mark, what's going on?
Nothing much. I have no clue what you thought of It Ends With Us, so I'm excited.
Yeah.
I'm excited to find out what that little tease was.
I mean, I was expecting something. I was expecting to react one way, and I definitely reacted a different way. So I'll just say that without giving away the game. Please rate and review the podcast on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. Those are the main ones that I look at, and it makes me feel good things inside when I find new reviews there. So, boy, was I delighted yesterday when I opened iTunes, or whatever you call it now, Apple Podcasts, and I saw a new review from someone named Slightly Magic, and they said, the headline is, "It works / it just doesn't work," and they said, "Take a drink every time you hear that, and you'll be a happy camper." Sometimes they are jaded on things when they find common tropes within films, or there is another movie that has the same kind of story. They treat it like it shouldn't exist. Oh, that's sad. I hope that's not true. That's the only real few negatives to this podcast. I should have started there, huh? And it's not really negative because reviews are subjective. Man, I felt so validated when I heard the review for Maxine. They are conscious of not ruining too many surprises within films, have sound analyzing skills, and are fun to listen to. Really enjoy these guys in my ear at work. I hope you enjoyed me reading that back, even though it was minorly painful for me to do so when I realized what was in there. Thank you so much. I think that's all valid, and I appreciate the 5 stars despite having some light misgivings. That's the beauty of the arbitrary nature of star ratings, which we are all about here at the podcast. I have some 3-star ratings today, Mark, that really run the gamut of, like, 3 stars, I fucking love this movie, and 3 stars, it's a pass. Enjoy. Really all of it is going to be covered today. So let's start with one of my most anticipated movies of the year as a person whose favorite movie of all time is Alien, the Ridley Scott 1979 movie, and a big fan of the franchise in general. I was obviously very excited for Alien Romulus, the first Alien movie since 20th Century Fox was acquired by Disney. So technically, this is a Disney movie. And that actually might have some relevance in the discourse about it. So I wanted to bring it up. Here's the trailer. We'll talk about it.
Is this really where you want to spend the rest of your life?
You know I don't.
Then this is our only ticket out of here.
That was more of a teaser than a trailer. Sorry for the listeners. There wasn't much going on for you there if you're not watching on YouTube. Mark, I think we're both coming at this from an interesting place, if only because we both really did not like Fede Alvarez's Evil Dead remake that a lot of horror fans love and say is one of the best remakes ever because it just goes hard, has all this crazy blood, and it's like crazy in that regard. But to me, it was so not in the spirit of what that franchise was that it didn't work for me at all. And I am pleased to report right up top, I really enjoyed this movie. And I think Fede Alvarez did a great job of emulating not just the atmosphere, but like the production design. It looks and feels like an Alien movie, which is not something I would have said about Evil Dead, being like, it looks like an Evil Dead movie. Like, no, it doesn't. It's a completely different thing. And maybe that's the difference. That was trying to be something different and do something different with the material that already exists. And this is very lovingly made, I would say, from like a fan doing pretty much fan service, or at least it doesn't start as fan service, but it definitely becomes fan service as the movie goes along. It just sort of, at a certain point, you start to realize the movie's just kind of remixing all the different Alien movies. And it's one of those things, Mark, where I know you're a Mark, but I'm a Mark for this franchise. I love it. So when they're doing fan service at me, I'm appreciating it. At the same time where I probably a couple weeks ago was making fun of Deadpool and Wolverine for offering fan service and people applauding like seals at things that they recognize or whatever. But I think there's a difference in what Alien Romulus is doing with the franchise and what a Deadpool is doing. But like, I see a lot of people already throwing around the like, this is like The Force Awakens, it's legacy sequel shit. And there's one really questionable element that we can talk about or talk around at some point. But that aside, which didn't ruin the movie for me, but I think it is a ethically dubious moral quandary that I just think didn't need to be in the movie whatsoever, and the movie works great without it. The way they shot around that at first, I was into. I was like, oh, they're teasing what I know it is, and I think that's fun. But then they reveal it, and you're like, oh, no. I wish they didn't do that. And then they show it a lot. but anyway, tell me what you thought of Alien Romulus and what it is.
It is, you know, it's set in between Alien and Aliens, and it's set on a different mining colony planet that the evil corporation is running, and so it's a group of scavengers trying to steal some cryopods to escape and get to an independent colony where they can live out their lives. They go into this derelict ship to steal the pods, and guess what? The aliens are there. That's the basic plot. You're right. It does take a lot of things. It's a remix, as you said it, but I also appreciated the fact of what it pulls from the various movies. I did not think they would be able to pull anything out of Alien Resurrection, but they do.
Boy, do they.
By the third act, I was shocked. Like, oh, this is actually kind of smart, because that was the one thing I remember from Alien Resurrection is right at the end, and what that could signify about the alien and everything. That's the only thing I really remember about Resurrection. I did my homework and rewatched Alien and Aliens. I thought that was enough. But
I also rewatched Alien, Aliens, and decided that like Prometheus and Alien Covenant also should be rewatched. And I did get to Prometheus, but I didn't end up getting to Covenant. But I'm glad I rewatched Prometheus.
Because yes, there's a little bit of that in there too. Yeah.
It's like, I found it fun that it decided to do all that stuff. And, you know, it's the same thing. Someone's going to come at me and say, yeah, but about this movie, you said it was stupid. And I'm like, yeah, it was stupid in that movie. But it works in this movie.
Yeah, it's different. It's different because this one actually takes it and does something with it in terms of trying to continue on the look of the alien, of the first alien. The fact that it does crib from 1979's Alien so much, just in terms of the plot and how
heavily
it works and how it functions and what it's doing and that slow buildup. I was kind of hooked right at the start when it's just a spaceship drifting through space in complete silence.
Yes. And thank you for saying that. I've already recorded the new Flash on Monday. You should listen to it. We get into everything about the movie, but that is one of the first things I mentioned that I was about to forget to mention. I was blown away from second one, frankly, when this movie started, because the camera is in space, just like literally in space. We're not in a spaceship yet. The camera's lingering in space and it's dead silent because that's You know, that's the whole thing about space. There's no sound there. So it was just a bold choice because it's one of those things where the movie's starting. So for me, I'm like, is the projectionist fucking up? Something's wrong. There's no sound right now. But I felt like I was in such good hands right away. And like the camera pans into the ship that we're going to be on. And then the sound gets on or whatever. Like it just was such a minor thing that set the tone so well. And as I said, I felt like I was in assured hands, I guess.
Because that's what's so striking about Alien, about the original film, is that it is all about establishing that tone and establishing that sense of helplessness and everything that is going on. That it's just this group on a ship and there's nothing they can do. There's nobody they can ask for help. No one can hear you scream. That's the entire point of it. And so having that initial setup in that way, and then expanding the world the way that Aliens does to show this mining colony and to get this idea of the corporation doing all these terrible things with working hours and indentured servitude. I was involved in it. I became instantly less involved with it, unfortunately, with the big reveal of a character from the original movie that doesn't need to be there. They could have just had any other synthetic character show up and give all of that backstory and exposition, which we already know, by the way, because we've seen Alien.
Yeah.
But that is one of those awful choices. And I think you might have brought up Disney because of, say, Rogue One does a similar thing where it pulls a dead actor,
Moff Tarkin,
into the movie for a key role. That doesn't need to be there. And it somehow even looks worse than the Grand Moff Tarkin stuff.
It does. It looks so
awful.
Like, that's what's stunning. Like, so we're not going to say who it is, I guess, but like, we're obviously alluding to something, a spoiler in the movie. But like, when they're teasing it out in the movie, as I said earlier, they're shooting around it. There's like, you can see the character, but it's at angles and it's lit as such that you don't see who, like, it's not lingering on the face. And I was like, this is tasteful. This is well done. But that lasts about 30 seconds. And then they go to this full CGI face of this dead person. And it's not just like a flourish of in a moment. It's like that character becomes a big part of the movie, which, you know, if I have any misgivings, that's a big one. But the only way that I am able to like let it, I mean, I'm able to like let it wash, you know, I'm able to forgive it anyway, but there's one justification that I could see an argument for why it's in there in like a meta commentary sort of way about evil corporations not caring about things like that. Like, it just reminds, like, Weyland-Yutani is Disney is like a commentary that Fede Alvarez is getting in here. Like, look what they made me do. They made me resurrect this guy. That is definitely a stretch. I think the movie is just engaging in fan service. It's doing callbacks. It's doing a lot of remember this kind of stuff. And like, did I need the stay away from her, you bitch line to be said? Like, do I need those moments? No. But like, I largely think it's cool that the movie is a remix of those other movies. And like, on a set piece perspective, like, I love the action set pieces in this movie. There's such suspense and tension. There's one, like, I just feel like they're ingeniously staged, and it definitely takes influence from video games in general, not just like Alien Isolation, which it does feel like it is. The Fetty's talked about playing that game. Like, it does feel like inspired by a person who's played that game. But it feels video gamey in other ways, like the other set pieces that are like, pull four levers and this will stop, or you have to keep your body temperatures a certain level with the room, even with the room, so the face huggers don't get you.
So it'd be a quick time event, like an Until Dawn or
exactly. Like, I can see like the health bar on the side or the energy bar for that. And there's another one where it's like you're floating, zero gravity, the aliens are dead around you and their acid blood is floating around and you have to get around that.
I really liked the zero G.
I love
moment.
That.
And the setup, the way that it sets up that idea that the zero G needs to recycle every so often, so that you add that level of tension, because there's a bunch of stuff just hanging in the air, not just the blood, but there's other things hanging in the air that are going to end up dropping at a certain point. I really, really like that. Those are the things that it does in terms of swapping or just adding to the mythology, or taking the mythology and adding some element to it. Like the idea of a bunch of face huggers chasing after them down a hallway. It's so simple, but it works so well. They're like rats on a sinking ship, basically, as things are going on. And that's how those things would probably behave in that kind of environment. We're more used to them hiding in shadows and jumping out and everything, but just seeing them chase after them through the hallway, I really like that moment.
When they're bursting through the door, I'm like, oh my God, like, I'm so scared. Yep. Like, it's just, I hate spiders and they look like spiders. I've always been scared of face huggers. And the movie also, which I'm sure we'll get to, in addition, like the practical effects, like there's like face hugger puppets there. Like there's not, I mean, they are CGI when they're jumping through the fucking door and stuff like that. The movie is a perfect marriage of practical effects and CGI, because like you don't notice the CGI. It doesn't call attention to itself, and the practical effects do. And like, I love when I can notice the animatronic xenomorph, or the puppet xenomorph, or a guy in a suit xenomorph. Like, they really didn't just like do the MCU, put it in the volume, CGI everything for this movie. They really cared. It feels like they paid attention to the details.
They did. There were shots out in space when the ship is docking with the space station that I was looking at it thinking, that looks like a practical model. That doesn't look like digital.
Oh, yeah. They use miniatures. They use miniatures.
Yeah. And it pays off when you do that, because it sticks around. We're still watching Alien and we're still watching Aliens, and all of that is practical effects, and it still holds up because those are tangible things that were done in camera.
Yeah. And then there's also like even the big spectacle of like there's like a ticking clock element to they're about to run into like the ring of a planet. And like the way that is rendered is so cool. As I said, I'm a mark for this franchise. So I feel like they were giving me fan service and I was shoving it down. I was appreciating it. So it didn't feel wrong, except for that one morally dubious choice that definitely took me out in the moment. But like, it didn't ruin the experience of the movie. Like, there's so many things going on in the movie. The corporate, you know, the corporation owning generations now. Like, your parents' debt is now, you owe the company time for that, for them too, and you have to pay that off. And they don't, you know, Kaylee Spanny's character was about to be done, but they just say, no, sorry, your contract's extended, and now you're stuck here forever, or whatever. And it is pretty funny that Fede Alvarez's outline was just, what if Don't Breathe, but in space? An alien, because like the setup is just, you know, a ragtag group of criminals go into a place and commit a crime. So I appreciated the simple setup, but I love, like, I thought it was inspired. Like, you don't usually see these type of characters in an Alien movie. The fact that they're like sneaking onto a ship is fun, and that they're young is also fun. It felt like a throwback to a slasher movie to me. It's like a bunch of young kids getting killed by a monster. So in terms of the haunted house horror movie that Alien was, that this is harking back to, I think it completely delivers on that. And I think it also delivers as an Alien sequel that I don't know if it has that many new ideas, but I think it brings up all the old ones in a way that I found to be not distracting, in like a nostalgic bait way for the most part. Like, I was it felt like a loving homage rather than like a boring retread, if that makes any sense.
It does. It's a loving homage but it's not cynical. It's actually trying to pull off the same sort of trick that Alien did. And it's nowhere near that, but
right.
After all of those other sequels, and, you know, I mean, I like Covenant, and I, you know, Prometheus is hit or miss with me on certain elements of it, but this feels like going back to the basics, and they pull it off, just making the aliens scary again in different ways that we haven't seen in these movies. I did appreciate that. I'm probably not as down with the movie as you are, but I still did enjoy it, and I still thought it was fun to watch all of this. And it's a good, solid movie.
Yeah, I think, you know, just having that look of the look and feel being right.
Much of it is that,
like, the look and feel being right overpowers the, like, God, why the fuck would they do that with what's his name? Like, it overpowers it for me. It just, like, it makes that stuff frustrating, because you're like, yeah, I didn't need it to go that far in its paying respects thing. I appreciated the all the movies in a blender thing, but it doesn't have to go so far with that.
Because when you go that far, then you stop paying respect and it starts being disrespectful. That's the problem with that character specifically being in it. And it's unnecessary because I like David Johnson's android, Andy the Melancholy Android. I really liked him.
Yeah.
You know, the android characters in these movies have always been fascinating, and he's another new one who has that his programming redone after he's on the stations.
Like essentially autistic until he gets an upgrade, and then he's totally different. And I thought like it was interesting. I thought that it was like at first I was like, bold move, autistic robot or whatever. Like they had to differentiate the robot somehow. I mean, that's how I read him. Did you not read him that way?
I don't know if I specifically, because he's just malfunctioning.
He's just a malfunctioning.
That's the
robot.
Idea in the beginning. Yeah. So I did not make that connection, but
that's funny. It felt I really felt like, because I mean, obviously he's revealed he's an android pretty quickly, but like that's the energy of the character. I thought was like a very great performance from the guy from Rye Lane, which is a movie we both recommended, I believe.
Yes, that was really good.
Yeah, it's just I didn't expect to enjoy this that much. It's got the anti-capitalist critique in there. It's got the legacy elements that I thought delivered. It just delivers as like, you know, the theme park ride experience with Jesse. My buddy Jesse keeps calling it. And like it does feel like you're going through a theme park experience with all the alien movies jumping out at you. And it works in that regard. I really enjoyed it. A very solid 3 stars for Alien Romulus for me.
Yeah, 3 stars for Alien Romulus for me as well.
Kaylee Spanny from Scylla and Civil War is really good as like the Ripley stand-in here. I was just with it the whole way. Obviously not the whole the little detours, but it got me back. I appreciated the resurrection by way of Prometheus third act or whatever. It's just fun. Like it makes me giddy to think that there's an alien sequel that, like, so much of horror sequels are all about, God, how many times is Halloween done, like, fuck those other sequels. We're going to forget 3, 4, 5, and we're going to do, this is a sequel to 1 and 2 only. Like, they're always doing shit like that. So I found it so refreshing that they were just like, no, everyone gets equal share here. Like, even 3, even just, like, the setting is kind of the homage to 3, I guess, like. The not quite a prison planet, but similar.
It's just a bigger space. It's a much bigger space for all the aliens to run around in.
Yeah. Yeah.
But still isolated and everything. So,
yeah. And it delivers this big screen spectacle. Like it really looks so good. Like I saw it in Dolby on a Dolby screen, the Dolby sound, and it was just terrific. Like I'm looking forward to going back. I think it is I think I saw an ad that said it will take up the full IMAX 190:1. Huge real IMAX screen ratio, so I will go see it in IMAX this week if I have time, and I'll report back if it fits the screen as it was supposed to. A lot of horror movies that I was anticipating this year, Mark, didn't work for me. Maxine, Long Legs, Cuckoo I enjoyed, but it was still not like being my favorites of the year list. Alien delivered to the degree where like I will see it again, and it might be on my end of the year list. I really, really liked it. And we'll see if that comes true. All right, what's next? Jackpot, a new Paul Feig action comedy that unfortunately is going straight to Amazon Prime. Here is the trailer.
So why are you here? Are you here for like pleasure or pain or?
No, I'm an actress. Great, they're rebooting Barbie.
Hi. I'm Katie, just got back into town and ready to act.
Did you prepare something?
I have something, yeah.
Katie Kim is our new jackpot winner. Happy hunting, LA.
I definitely didn't get the part, so there's no need for the dead stare.
She's my jackpot.
What is happening?
Uber for Katie? Did that look as cool as it felt?
What is going on?
Katie, you won the lottery. And now anyone with a losing ticket that kills you before sundown gets your money.
This has a very silly high concept that I will let Mark explain. But I found it to be unexpectedly amusing, despite seeming like it had a very one-note premise, because it's just kind of relentless. It just keeps moving. And the action it's like action comedy in the vein of, like, I don't know how you describe it, like Jackie Chan or something, where like there's a lot of interaction with the environment. There's a lot of like, she's not good at fighting, but she's still getting these people knocked out anyway with randomness. And it's all shot competently because Paul Feig has done this a lot. And that stuff's all well done to the point where this is my, it's a pass. I liked it enough to recommend. I thought it was fine. I think you liked it a little less. I'm curious.
I liked it slightly less because I was all on board with it when it's just that relentless action comedy stuff with a heavy dose of comedy over the action, which I'm fine with because the setup is completely nonsensical, that it's the very near future. I suppose the one thing that's kind of honest, or at least a little cynical, that I appreciate about it is how quickly apparently society will descend into madness, because it's only 6 years in the future and the entire state of California now has a lottery where if you win, everybody else who bought a ticket and lost can kill the winner and steal the jackpot from them. And that's the basic premise. Awkwafina is in LA after spending time with her sick and dying mom, taking care of her. She comes back to revive her acting career from childhood. And she, through a very elaborate thing that I don't want to get into, ends up in somebody else's clothes, has the ticket that wins, and then is chased by most of Los Angeles trying to kill her. No guns. You can't use guns. You have to use, you know, your fists or anything else. Knives, wasp venom, bullets, I think is one of the things.
Yes.
Whatever. So Awkwafina is doing her shtick of being completely out and unaware of what's going on and trying to fight without trying to fight and doesn't know what's happening. And I like her, and she's very funny here. And then John Cena pulls in, and that's when it came to life for me, because the Awkwafina John Cena team up was not one I was expecting to work or even thought about working, but it's really good here. Cena is so good at playing the deadpan straight guy who doesn't know what's good. He's just polite and professional. Yeah. And then Awkwafina is out there and doing all of her stuff, and it works. It's
she was
funny.
Making me laugh a lot more than usual, just with her random asides that are actually funny. Like there's the thing John Cena does where he's like, he knocks people out, but then he like helps them so that they don't choke on their tongues or something.
And
he's like, you know, you wouldn't like it if they choked on their tongues. And she goes, actually, I would love that. Like, they're trying to kill me. What do you mean? Like, go ahead. Just little things like that. And him saying something about her hands, and she's her being like, I'm not looking for hand compliments right now in the middle of action scenes. It sounds so stupid when I describe it, but like, she sells it. And there's definitely people who aren't going to buy the shtick. If you don't like her shtick, it won't work for you. But I found her to be very charming and funny in this, as I do find her often, but the movie actually works. We're like, you know, what was something she's in recently that didn't work? Like, Renfield does not work, even though she's probably fine in it. Like, the movie worked. Quiz Lady was a good one, where she was good as
Quiz
well.
Quiz Lady was good. She's very good in that.
Yeah, she's good. She's good. She's good.
Yeah, I like her. She's funny. I think she's good. But the way that this just pummels you with joke after joke after joke.
Yes.
That's why, because even if something is a dud, there's a joke coming up right in the next bit that
that
is funny.
Her Airbnb or roommate lady is really funny. Aiden Meyerie,
yes,
it gets a lot of laughs in this. And there's a lot of supporting characters, like the mom from Freaks and Geeks, is it? Who's one of the people trying to kill her, who robs her early on.
Yes.
Yeah, like it's a lot of fun.
It's that nice girl whose watch I stole.
Killer. Yes. Yeah, it's just silly. It's very silly. It's using this, you know, dystopian setting as an excuse to do an action comedy. It's like farcical. I appreciated it, Mark. Did you get? I mean, it's laid on thick, so I'm sure you did get it. But I appreciated it as like, it's just a metaphor about moving to Hollywood and trying to be a star and what the experience is like. Like, I think it really works from that lens, and I thought I appreciated that. Like, It wasn't just a silly action comedy to me. Like, it did have another layer of like, yeah, this is a movie about LA and the experience of trying to be a star and how some people make it and some people don't. And it's just an extreme version of that. And I really,
the idea that some people make it for the wrong reasons.
Yeah, sure. Why, absolutely.
She is famous by the end of it but the downside is everyone's trying to kill her. I don't think the satire works here. I don't think it does. I don't think, and that's part of my reservation about not recommending it. And my big reservation is the third act, dropped like a lead, like a just like a stone. I read your thing
or like your blurb said that, and I was like, I don't remember it dropping like a stone. I just think it like ends like
Adds the Simu Liu character where he's
sure.
All of that, it stops being about the nonstop jokes, and it starts being about this weird conspiracy about this. It really makes no sense. Why is there a isolated economies dedicated to protecting jackpot winners when this thing happens once a month? And even then, I think it can go on like any other lottery.
Yeah. I also just took that as like movie industry satire about people leeching off of like agents or leeching off you. It's not very deep or anything,
not deep, and it's not logically sound, and I'm okay with it not being logic. I'm okay with the premise not being logically sound when the entire intent is just give you a bunch of jokes and action sequences that are fun. But once it gets into just talking about the backstory of Cena's character and Awkwafina's character and Liu's character coming in being who he is and trying to do what he does and all that, and separating the two leads by a certain point in that stops what I was latched onto and what I was connected to was that dynamic between the two of them, the mismatched dynamic between them. It's, you know, it's a simple gimmick, but it's fun here. And as soon as that's gone, along with everything else, it flattened for me.
Yeah,
which is too bad because I was on board with it for a long stretch here.
Yeah, I think what's key is that just that nonstopness from the first hour, I guess, of it is what really kept me going, because it does stop and have emotional arc backstory at some point. And I was like, all right, this is stretching its limits, I guess. But I don't know. I'm definitely still thought it was worth watching and unexpected, like because I expect these straight to streaming things to be so fucking bad that I was just surprised that it was competent in any way. Like, it's one of those things where it's like low expectations where I was able to enjoy it. So maybe have low expectations. I appreciated the cottage industry being propped up around the lottery and stuff like that. I don't know. Like, I just was kind of on board for what they were doing, I guess. The premise is literally just, you know, the scene from John Wick where all the hitmen are trying to kill him at the same time. But that's the whole movie. It's all, you know, most dangerous game riff, whatever you want to call it. So it's familiar, but injected with enough new and comedy to make it work. I thought it was good enough. I give it 3 stars. I liked it.
Yeah, that's fair. I mean, I'm only giving it 2.5. And so that's my famous on the fence sort of thing. It's not a recommendation. It's not a recommendation. Blah, blah, blah. All the usual stuff.
Mark cannot be held responsible for your reaction.
I cannot, but I get liking it, because I really did like it for probably about an hour or so. I was really with it, and then it lost me once it becomes a third movie by the third act. I couldn't get onto that part of it. So 2.5 for Jackpot for me.
2.5 for Jackpot on Amazon Prime now. All right, let's talk about Didi, a movie I saw, God, a month ago, that's been playing in limited release. It is now in wide release, I believe. So it's actually a perfectly fine time for us to talk about it. Here is the trailer for Didi.
What was your name again?
Chris. All my friends just call me Wang Wang.
Well, what should I call you? You're never gonna survive high school.
You're like a lizard with your scaly ass eczema skin.
It's a face!
Ah, lizard bitch!
Just call me a bitch!
Bitch.
I'm like a bitch. Shut the fuck. Nobody loves you!
All that drag me down. What time you can kill me? But I'll
thanks, that. 保持 4.0 的 GPA. Oh, Chris, hey, video.
Yo, Wang Wang, don't even trip. You got strong-ass teeth. You're handsome. That's why Manny likes you, baby.
Now, Mark, I understand that you didn't necessarily relate to this movie as much as I did, as someone who found just the sound of AOL Instant Messenger and the accompanying noises of AOL or whatever else is in this movie. It's just such a, it's so evocative of a certain era that was the same era that I was this kid's age and growing up, that I, talking about being a fucking mark for something, I am a mark for this movie as well. And I thought it was like, I don't think you need to be, I feel like a lot of people like it who didn't have the same experience I did, but like I also made Jackass style videos and put them on YouTube when I was that age, and like I just to a T trying to get in with the skater kids, all my experience, awkward around girls, even on Instant Messenger, and self-sabotaging, not knowing who you are and trying to figure it out, there's specifics about like it's specific to a Taiwanese American identity thing where like he also feels weird about that and like pretends like he's half white when he's not. Like there's stuff like that that I can't personally relate to, but I relate it to everything around it so much. It's one of those things where it's like in the specific I found universal lessons type of thing, where like I really appreciated this as a coming of age movie, as a movie where someone, you know, discovers who they want to be. Like I just love these kind of movies. It was like Eighth Grade or Lady Bird, but for skater dudes in their 30s who skated and listened to fucking Paramore in 2000. And what year is it? It must be like 2006, 7, 8 or something.
Somewhere in there. It's because Facebook is apparently just becoming a thing, because MySpace is still around in this. So,
yes. Oh, my God. Yeah. The visceral reaction of being demoted from somebody's top 8. Like this movie brought me back in a way that I did not fucking appreciate, frankly. Yeah, I definitely have like a visceral response to it in that way, though. So that maybe that explained why you didn't connect with it. I think that's what.
Oh, no. Oh, no, 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 no.
No, there's other reasons.
I have deeper issues with it than just I couldn't connect to.
Lay it on me.
Of being a young teenager and not knowing my place in the world. That's a common thing. That's my issue with this. I'm just going to put it bluntly. I didn't like the kid. I think the actor is fine. I think the actor is good. I didn't like the character. I didn't understand.
I appreciated his unlikability. Yeah, like him. I mean, I was also thrown by the opening scene that's like in the trailer there, where he like is doing a mail bomb thing, and you're like,
but that
unsympathetic character.
Yeah, but it turns out that the entire mail bomb thing is to cover up the fact they tortured a squirrel and are trying to hide the evidence.
Yes,
like, there's some stuff here that's uncomfortable.
Uncomfortable honesty is like part of why I was like, this is a little different than stuff that would like sand off the edges. I appreciated the edges, but please continue.
He's so angry. He's so resentful. And I don't think the movie digs deep enough into his character to get at why he is. It's just throwing you like these broad ideas. Like his dad is off in Taiwan working, so he's alone with his mom and his sister and his grandmother, and they're always fighting. There's always these he and his older sister are fighting just because they're siblings and they fight. He and his mom are fighting occasionally because he's a teenage boy and doesn't want his mom around and finds her embarrassing. And then it turns out the grandmother, who seems really nice, is digging into the mother about the fact that the grandmother's son is not there. There's all this negativity going around, which is fine. I get it. It's going at that. But give us a little bit of something. Give us a little bit of insight. Show us some sort of external perspective on this kid, because I really don't think he gets anywhere by the end. The movie is telling us he does, but it's giving us these little gestures of he has improved. He has learned his lessons. He has figured out where he is, what he has done wrong. Yeah. And I didn't see it because it's so bogged down by him being angry and resentful and jealous and all of these things that you
that's
don't
what
have
it's this. Like
I know I get like. It I get it yeah. I do yeah, yeah, get yeah. it I'm not saying yeah. anything about yeah. that I'm saying that is accurate, but
yeah,
it just is that over and over and over again. By the end, I get it. Give us something else. Give us something to at least build up to that moment of those last couple of scenes where everything sort of resolves to some degree, that we can see it. I didn't see it. I didn't buy it, because it's all that stuff. The entire racial element, there's some really interesting ideas here. That scene with the girl where she says that he's cute for being Asian, that's really uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And the movie doesn't address it at all, except for maybe
Maybe
that's why he says
yeah.
father is white, and because he's just you know,
yeah, I mean, I think it's all about that. Yeah, that's crazy.
I don't think it's all about that. I think that's stretching it, that it's all about that. It's there. Yeah. I don't think the movie explores it that much.
Huh. Yeah. So this is one of those movies where I feel like you're probably seeing mostly praise and you're like, I don't get it.
Yeah. I don't get it.
Yeah. Oh, man. Yeah. I guess this is one of those movies that if you don't connect with that kid, you're not going to care or get invested in it. And I definitely cared about this kid for the reasons you're describing, I feel like the vulnerability of him being like shitty and not knowing how to not be shitty. He's like, it's because we're all shitty at that time, I feel like. I don't know. I really like this, and it definitely reminded me of my experience in good ways and bad, just the universal insecurities of not knowing who you are yet kind of stuff. It just, that plus like the stuff with his mom trying to deal with her own stuff, that you like, there's a really heartbreaking scene in there that got me to cry, probably, if I remember correctly. Like, yeah, I don't know. I found it very relatable, despite not on the surface, it's like, it shouldn't be relatable. We're so different. Like, no, it was very relatable for me. I'm sorry it didn't work for you. It's a bummer.
Don't apologize. It's not your fault.
Well, yeah, it was one of those ones. I was like, Mark's going to like this one. We'll talk about it. That's interesting. I was just right in that window. He's, I guess, a little younger. 2008, I would have been 17. So he's a little younger than me, but like, I still had all those same experiences growing up online. And God, there's a really funny scene where he's pretending to like a movie that a girl likes.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh yeah, I love A Walk to Remember. And she's like, really? And then he like goes and reads the description.
Most guys don't like that.
Yeah. And you hear him go like, oh no. Or like, you hear like, he doesn't want like some sort of facepalm or something. Like, it was funny.
I did like the way that the computer is used, and the like how MySpace is used and how Messenger is used. Like,
yeah, I feel like
blocking somebody
so
on Messenger. That is the ultimate, like, no, you are out of my life. I did like that stuff because that does feel accurate.
Yeah. It reminded me of like in the movie, those like Screen Life movies, like Unfriended or something, or like Searching, how like there's so much weight to like someone typing and the bubbles are there, they go away, or like dragging something to the trash, but then you don't do it. You know what I mean? Like using this movie isn't exactly that, but like it does use the computer and stuff like that in ways that tell the story that I found to be completely natural as someone who was on the computer at that time. Very solid 3-star coming of age movie that people my age, I think, will certainly relate to. And, people more, we're not that different in age.
I think we're like 10 years apart. It's not that, not that,
but that's the big, it could explain the difference in this specific movie.
But I still used AIM. I still used MySpace. I still used all this stuff. I was just older when I did it, but when I was this kid's age, there was other stuff that was sort of
harrowing
corollaries to it. You know, there is. Yeah. I mean, I get it. I get being that age. I would rather forget it, but you know, here we are. I resent the movie for being so accurate about that stuff, but I still,
now we're getting somewhere. Yes, we're digging deep.
I'm kidding.
I'm joking.
I did not pull up any mailboxes.
No, it's just like,
it was reading books and being awkward.
Well, that's why. Maybe it's just reminding you of those times you're like, no thanks.
Oh no. I get it.
No thanks.
I get it.
Yeah,
dig deeper. That's my lesson here. I'm giving it 2 stars. That's where I'm at.
Wow. All right. 3 stars for me for Didi. Didi in theaters now. All right. Next up, Rob Peace, a movie based on a book that if I told you the title of the book, it would spoil the movie. That's why they changed it to Rob Peace. It's written and directed by, oh boy, I at one point knew this effortlessly, Chiwetel Ejiofor, is that correct?
Ejiofor.
I will get it right. He's on great. on the other side of the trailer for sure, just to clarify. Out of ultimate respect for this actor, I think is great. This is, as far as I know, his writer director debut. Not true?
It's his second one.
Oh, well, okay.
Yeah.
Didn't look it up. I was going off a whim. I never saw that other one, I don't think. So we'll talk about that in a second. Here's the trailer for Rob Peace.
So that's 22.5 times 2.
Huh?
45 plus 11.25 is 56.25.
Ah, damn. Can't be 7 years old smarter than your old man.
All right. We can walk to my place from here. Oh.
That was the last day I remember being a child. I did not commit this crime.
The jury finds the defendant, Robert E. Douglas, guilty.
I'll take care of everything. I promise. You're going to college. The best thing you could do for your daddy is to keep being brilliant.
You got it again!
I'm not here to educate. I'm trying to learn. I'm trying to figure out the best way to help my community when the time comes.
It's time for you to fly.
Chiwetel Ejiofor, star of Rob Peace, writer and director of Rob Peace. I'll say my piece real quick, and then I'll throw it to Mark. Condensing and streamlining this book must have made it feel more contrived than the story actually likely is. Because I found this to have strong performances and compelling ideas and at least one fucking absolutely heartbreaking, devastating scene that almost made me cry, even though the movie, I don't know if it got me there ultimately. It just starts to feel at a certain point like less like characters and more like the themes are there. You know what I mean?
I do exactly know what you mean, because that's sort of my reaction to it too. It has this one core idea that's set up right away through that opening narration of cause and effect. And so you have this kid whose life should be this extreme bit of promise. He's intelligent, he's, you know, much smarter than all the kids in his class. He gets into Yale, he has plans to get a PhD, he could do everything and anything basically. And because of his circumstances and what happens around him in terms of the neighborhood he grew up in and what happens with his dad being arrested for double murder and trying to save his dad from prison because he's convinced his dad is innocent and all of that stuff, that's the cause that eventually leads to the effect of him having to do something that goes outside of what his dream and ambition is because he has no other choice, basically. So I really liked all of that stuff, and I liked that core idea, and it's thoughtful about how just either little or big things are just unexpected things, like the housing crisis and your dad being, you know, accused of double homicide. It's, you know, those are things that just come out of nowhere and just, you know, knock you up against the wall. And what are you going to do about it? I did like that it's thoughtful about that. And then it gives you a sense of this kid doing and this young man doing what he thinks he needs to do to save his family, because he has this burden. It becomes a burden of having to do all that stuff. I did like that. I appreciated it. I think it is well performed. The lead is, it's a Jay Will. This is a debut performance. He's really good.
He's really good. Yeah. I thought the first hour of this was really good. I think. I feel like.
Yeah, I did too.
Yep. I feel like it just it hits a wall where you're like, okay, well, this was obviously setting up the one way it could go, and it just goes there. And it's disappointing because it's like a narrative we've seen in movies before, I guess. But like, that makes it sound so shitty when you're like, this is like a real guy's story. And like, they're just putting it on the screen. How can you say it's cliche kind of thing? But it's like, because the movie went about it in a cliched way, I guess. I don't know. You know what I mean? Like, when he starts doing what you're saying, like doing what he has to do to get by, it's just like, yeah, it just like, that's what was going to happen because that's what you told me was going to happen. So like something about it like lacks just like narrative tension or something too, because I feel like it's just like you're kind of just waiting for the thing to happen that it says was going to happen, and then by the time it gets to like the thing that the title of the book would have ruined for you, you're like, do you wonder what the point was of hearing this story? Like, I don't know, it just feels like at certain point like maybe it's just like a sad story, and I don't know, I don't know why I ended up questioning this movie by the end of it, because I was really with it for an hour.
Yeah, for me, it's because those situations become the focus. It's more about what happens to Rob and less about who he is. I think at the beginning, when you're starting to understand who this kid who becomes, you know, this really bright teenager who gets into Yale just off of, you know, the strength of his grades and, you know, his mother working to help him get into that private school. When you have this, when you're learning about him, it is more interesting than just seeing all of this stuff happen to him over and over again.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that that didn't happen to the real Rob Peace or anything. I'm just saying that this is the way the movie feels when you do just say focus on what happens instead of who this man is and what he could have been and accomplished versus what ended up happening. Yeah, I think the focus maybe just by that second half kind of just switches over more into melodrama instead of focusing on the character. Because there's an entire romantic subplot that kind of gets pushed aside. There's the relationship with his mother, who's so supportive, is just kind of in the background and occasionally pops up. Everything about the father is all about the court case and the legal stuff, and it has nothing to do about their relationship once that event happens. And maybe it's just missing that.
But that scene,
the human element versus the situational one.
I bet you know what scene I mean when I say there's one heartbreaking scene, like with him and his son late in the movie. It just like was devastating.
Really good.
It's devastating when, especially when you find out what you find out after. Because it would have prevented that scene from happening probably had he known that. So. It's really devastating. Like, I'm like, how does this movie with a scene that powerful ultimately wind up with me giving it 2.5 stars? You know what I mean? Like, I feel torn about this movie because, like, it's not, I don't think it's bad. I just think it's issues. It's amateurish in its execution, I guess, to the point where you're waiting for the morality of it all to hit. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. It made me want to read the book.
It's missing something. I think the finger I'm putting on it is that it is all that focus on the situational stuff. And maybe, I don't know what it was for you, but there is something, the fact that we're both feeling like there is something, there is a hole here in this movie. Where is it? And why is it not as affecting as it should be? I think that says there is something off about it, which is too bad because it's a strong story. It's got strong performances. It has a very compelling horror thematic idea about just circumstances defining a person, no matter what they try to do. It's intriguing, but yeah, I'm giving it 2.5 stars too, ultimately, which is too bad.
Yeah. It's got all that stuff with him, like using science terminology to like affect his environment and his community in the worst, how he sees the world. It was just working. It was working for so well for so long that I just was kind of taken aback by the narrative things that happened that are not as compelling as you said, the character work that came before it. Yeah. 2.5 stars for Rob Peace, but check out don't look up the book if you don't want to be spoiled, but then.
Please don't, because they don't even tell you in the beginning of the movie what the title of the book is. It's just a book by this guy.
Yeah. Cause it would absolutely, you'd be like, oh no. Anyway, next movie, speaking of, oh no, here is My Penguin Friend with Gene Reno, icon, Leon the Professional's in this. Here is the trailer.
Hello.
Wait.
Why is a penguin in our home?
It needs our help. Look at this oil on you. Don't move. I will get you clean.
It's a penguin. His name should be Ding Ding.
Now, this is a movie that's easier to pin down, like, why it doesn't work. Because on paper, it seems like a home run, like a fastball down the middle, a movie about a guy's relationship with a penguin. And it's like a credible true story where this penguin did like leave across the ocean and come back to this guy, right? Like they do have a relationship. It's a great story. And it makes for a great 10 seconds in the credits at the end of the movie when you see the actual footage or whatever. It's one of those things. Does it pass the, would a documentary about this be better test? No, it doesn't pass. It fails. A documentary would have been better about this. This movie, all I remember, I watched this like a month ago. It opens with such intense drama, melodrama. There's like a dead kid involved, I feel like. It just is so heavy, and it never gets into like any sort of fun rhythm with like this guy and his penguin. It's just kind of like a sad movie that I never once was engaged in a moment of it. Like, what was wrong with this movie for you?
It's trying to do too many things at once when the very simple story of just a penguin showing up at this guy's house and spending time with him sounds just so heartwarming. And it is, instead of just saying, this is what happened, and isn't that nice that this older man found a friend in a penguin? Isn't that sweet? Yes, it is. You're spot on. That last like 10 seconds just of seeing the real man with the penguin is so, so heartwarming. I'm like, why isn't any of that in the movie? Why am I more affected? Why is there more of an emotional impact seeing the real person and the real penguin together than this entire movie that does create a dead kid and creates this whole thing of the man trying to compensate and atone for the fact that his child died, and the penguin going off on a bunch of adventures in town and back home on the island where a bunch of researchers are trying to decide whether or not to take him to a university to be studied. There's so much going on that it just distracts from the fact that this is a really good story at its heart. And the movie loses all of that heart because it's trying to do so much.
Yeah. And if I recall correctly, it doesn't even give you like the Animal Planet nature doc penguin footage that you want. Mostly it's mostly like CGI antics, like sliding around or something. And there's like, it's really amateurish and cheap looking. Like, there's really bad green screen in this. I even thought like the shot composition and editing was like awkwardly put together. There's a big jump forward in time at the way I said that at the beginning.
But there's also jumps forward in time in the narrative of the man and the penguin, because you don't. This takes place over the course of years, and it feels like it's happening in like 2 weeks because it's so rushed because it's doing so many things.
Yeah, and one of the things is like the most cliche thing ever, where it's like you got an unwanted animal in your house and he's making a mess of your toilet paper. Like, it's just, I've seen this before. And it should be, I'm like frankly annoyed at this movie, because like it should be such an easy layup. Like, that was heartwarming. I want to take my kid to that or tell my mom to watch that. And instead, there's like nothing to recommend here. Like, this movie is like a chore to sit through. It's boring. It looks terrible. Like, I thought it was really bad. It was surprisingly bad. It's a 1.5-star movie for me. If there's anything else to say about it, please continue.
I don't know if there's anything much to say about it. Some of those inventions that I mean, the dead kid turns out to be an invention. I found that out after the fact, because the guy's grandkid is the one who names the penguin. So it's not even being accurate or honest about that core part of the entire movie.
That's outrageous that they invented a dead kid to be the backstory of this movie that didn't need a dead kid in it. Like, the whole reason I was giving it the benefit of the doubt, even though I'm still not liking the movie, but I was like, well, sure, that's this guy's backstory. They have to put it in the movie. And if it's not, the whole fucking thing falls apart. I'm like, why are you showing me this? That's so weird.
I don't know. But it does give us some penguin eye view and the idea that maybe the penguin could be the reincarnation of the kid, or that the penguin senses the dead kid around while he's walking through the forest.
Oh, good.
It's such a weird movie. It's such a weird movie. I'm giving it 2 stars.
Wow.
I didn't hate it. I didn't hate it. I know a lot of people did. I've seen a few people other
than you. That's funny.
Really hate this movie.
Yeah, it really annoyed me. I was looking for like an easy watch, and it was like torture. It was not a fun experience. It should be a fun experience, and instead you're like, why am I getting it? Why are you telling me about this guy's sad story? Okay, I guess it's based on a true story. It's probably worth listening to. You made it up, and it's just, there's actually just a nice story here that you made sad. It's just so confusing. 1.5 stars for My Penguin Friend. A very bad movie starring a very great actor, Gene Reno. Am I pronouncing that right? That's how I've always pronounced it.
I mean, it's French, so I assume it's Jean Reno. I'm assuming. I mean,
yeah. Yeah, Gene Reno. Someone's going to laugh at people are going to laugh at my pronunciation of that. It's definitely not right. But I've been calling him that.
Famous cathedral in Paris.
Mm, yeah, that one.
I'm just.
I'm not smart enough to know what that is.
Oh, also the name of a famous university in Indiana.
What, Notre Dame? Played.
Yeah. Yeah, there we go.
Yeah. Beautiful. All right. What else we got? Three more. Next up, we've got skincare. This is another movie where I have just questions. Here's the trailer.
Joining us in the studio today is the skincare queen, Hope Goldman. You really are the American dream.
Reputation is everything in this business.
Your career is legendary, and your story is inspiring as hell.
Beauty is a cutthroat business.
Business is a cutthroat business.
I hope you don't think I'm intruding on your territory.
Why would you lease to another facialist?
Maybe you should worry more about why you told me you would pay the rent on time.
Things are about to blow up.
This movie had me asking the question, why? Like, why am I watching this movie about, like, a small-time petty rivalry between skincare stores at a mall? It just really begs the question, like, it's like, clearly, it's, what does it say up top? Actually, very annoyingly, it says a fictional story based on true events, which, a, fuck you, that's annoying. But I just kept wondering, like, is this gonna rise to the level of should be filmed entertainment at any point? And I never really thought that the story ever did rise to the level of this would make an interesting movie. Like, it's just kind of about someone like business rivalry and someone trying to take control of her narrative, I guess you would say. There's a Lewis Pullman is in it as like a life coach slash bullshit artist. I don't know. It's just a weird movie. Explain it. I'm not doing a good job. Help me.
No, I mean, there's really not much to it. It's one of those that stretches that whole inspired by a true story thing, because it doesn't even tell you at the end, oh, this is actually what happened, or this is what it's based on. And I think that has to do with some legal stuff that's going on behind the scenes, because the real person is not appreciative of the fact, because the real person wants to own their own narrative. And so
the real person wants a Netflix documentary. She's like, well, now they're not going to fucking make one because Elizabeth Banks made a movie about me, but they changed the name and stuff. So it's essentially
the name. They changed some of the story. I don't, who knows?
Yeah. I didn't read the full story.
I didn't care. That is the most damning thing about this movie, is that I see this story that is supposedly so shocking and so confounding and so getting at something about business and human nature and all that. And I'm just sitting there thinking, I don't really care that much, and I don't care enough to look that much into what actually happened. And I should be fascinated by
and,
this when it is so weird that it is, you know, skincare specialists in Beverly Hills competing against each other, and somehow it results in online harassment and fake porn and I'm trying
rape
to think what
fantasy
else
Craigslist ad.
yeah all this awful terrible stuff, and I didn't here by the end. Although I do think Elizabeth Banks is really good here. I think she's really good, and I that's about the extent I can really get at it. And I think in when it's just starting up, it has interesting ideas about women in business and the challenges that they have to face and all of that stuff, like the Nathan Fillion character essentially trying to extort her to get a interview she recorded previously onto television instead of just, you know, broadcasting it like they said they would. That's an interesting idea that just ends up being another piece of all the stuff that you have to dig through to get to the truth, which the movie also reveals too early, I think.
Yeah, and it also, like, I was expecting, because of the title and like the, I actually thought this movie looked pretty good. Like, it has really good close-ups of like face masks going on faces, and like it just had good photography and stuff. I kept waiting for it to like be about beauty and women and how they like just something. Didn't you expect it to have some sort of like, oh yeah, people do rely on skincare products. You know, I expected some sort of social commentary, and this movie's not interested at all in that. It's just, I just feel like I don't know what the movie, like what they're selling. Like, what am I looking at? Like, your movie called Skincare. with that evocative poster. The opening scene I even thought was really evocative and interesting with her, like,
she's getting ready for that thing that's about to happen.
Like, I was so interested, and then it just, like, it reveals itself to, like, not really be there's no there.
Does
it's truly
prologue, you know what, I'm thinking about it, does that weird flash forward prologue give away too much right at the top too?
Probably.
I said that it reveals what's actually happening too early, because it's about halfway through, and now I'm thinking maybe that, you know, that idea you have to give the audience something to cling to that seems more actiony or something, you know, of eventful right at the beginning, does that give away too much? Because now we're expecting what's going to happen.
Yeah.
So I don't know about that too. Maybe it's just structured weird, and that's the biggest problem with it.
Yeah. Truly more like Skin, I don't care. I could not care less about this movie. It felt like a chore, even though, I don't know, Lewis Pullman's good. She's good. It just doesn't work. I just kept wondering, when will this be more than like a local news story with little intrigue and nothing to say about anything? And that's all it is. So 1.5 for me from Skincare. It didn't do anything for me.
Yeah. I mean, I get that, but I think it does have something to say, at least maybe the first half hour or so. And I do think Banks is really good here. I'm giving it 2 stars, and that's maybe a little generous for Skincare, but that's where I landed.
Skincare, an IFC film, probably in limited release and on demand soon. Let's talk about Consumed.
What do you think?
I think you have outdone yourself. Thank you for this. I can't lose you now. Do you think I heard something? What could have done this?
What the hell?
Quit your hollering. You'll bring the beast down on us.
What is that thing?
The Devon Sawa sense continues unabated, but I did not like this movie. Set it up for me. What is this? Because truly, I watched it. It's one of those ones. I watched it not long ago, but I retained almost nothing, because it feels like a nothing movie.
It is kind of, and I'm thinking that too now that you threw it to me. It's husband and wife go out on a camping trip, and things go wrong, as they tend to do in movies on camping trips where people are alone. The hook here is that the wife is a year out from a cancer recovery, so that's the entire reason for them to go on the trip. Then they find a bunch of flayed bodies in a temple or ruins. And then Devon Sawa's character, a hunter who's been in the woods on his own hunting a Wendigo, shows up and protects them. And then they have to hunt the Wendigo. That's basically it.
And the Wendigo is CGI, like wind? Like, what would you call it?
Oh, wait. It's like smoke. It's the smoke monster from Lost, essentially, with a little bit of fire. Thrown in for good measure, just to make it a little more visually interesting, I guess. You do see the monster, which might have been a mistake, but
yeah,
you know, I don't know. It's definitely not Alien Romulus territory in terms of practical effects when that shows up.
No, definitely not.
This is such a hard one. It's not terrible. It's just so generic. It's just a generic. People in the woods and there's a monster running around.
Yeah, really cheap. Like, they're just in the woods. Like, there's no budget here whatsoever. It probably costs nothing. There's some interesting horror imagery in here, though. As you said, like, the flayed bodies and stuff look pretty, like, those are practical and they're cool looking. And then there's, like, the breast cancer body horror imagery of, like, her ripping herself open or whatever. And, like, there's some stuff in here that I was intrigued by, but, like, there's no, like, through line or narrative or story that keeps you engaged. It's just like truly just trudging through the woods with this guy as you're like, he's telling you what he's doing. And you never really get a handle on it, do you?
Everything that is interesting, all those ideas about the cancer and all the stuff that's going on with Sawa's character, it's all in between the lines, because it's really just trying to show you all the monster stuff, which is so just so routine. It doesn't do much of anything. And it doesn't, I'm just now remembering that some people who have been following Devin Sawa's most recent career might be with the flayed bodies, might think of a much better movie in the woods called Hunter Hunter.
That movie's awesome. Yeah.
Oh, it's so good. Let's just talk about that one instead.
Hunter Hunter. Where is it streaming? It might be a Shudder thing. Let me look. Hunter Hunter. Apparently is the name of an anime, so it's Google is having a hard time. It's on AMC Plus, which means it's on Shudder. Yeah, it's on Shudder.
There we go. Okay.
It's
a much better horror movie with Devin Sawa in it.
Yeah, 2020 horror movie with Devin Sawa has the most shocking ending of a movie I've seen in years, and it's still true. So that was 4 years ago. So that's my recommendation for Consumed, is check out Hunter Hunter. That's probably a 3.5-star movie, and Consumed is a 2-star movie for me.
Yeah, it's not doing anything terrible. It's just it is just so routine that we both have forgotten about it, and we both saw this not that long ago.
It's completely passed through. Yeah.
2 stars for me too. I remember the performances being pretty good, and it's some of the ideas and imagery kind of neat, but it's just going through the motions of all that monster movie stuff and not doing anything interesting with it.
All right. Let's move on to a movie from last week. Did it beat Deadpool? Was it number one at the box office? I don't remember.
It
did beat Deadpool. It made $50 million. It beat Deadpool in its third weekend. It's a sensation. It's based on a hugely best-selling book by Colleen Hoover. I know a lot about it. I've been inundated with the press tour shenanigans. There's a lot of Blake Lively re-edited the movie with her guys and took it away from the director, who happens to also be the star of the movie. There's a bunch of outside controversy. You can Google and read all about all these rumors. A lot of people are shitting on Blake Lively for being mean and stuff. There's a lot of stuff going on, but we're not talking about any of that. We're going to talk just about the movie, and I saw it, and you're going to be surprised. Here's a trailer.
Hey, Lily, you want to do the honors?
No, you go ahead. I need to take it in from here.
I was hoping you'd say that. Okay. Oh, my God. Oh, that's my brother, Ryle.
The first official customer?
Well, you'd have to buy something to be considered a customer. Right now, you're just loitering.
We all have an idea of what love can be.
I want to see you again.
Now you see me.
You know what I mean.
That special connection you feel. That first kiss. But 15 seconds.
Ooh. All right. I'm going to keep teasing. You go. What did you think?
Really? Oh, man.
Yes.
So it's the story. I'm desperate to know, but okay, I'll wait a little bit longer. It's okay. It's okay. So it is a romance between Blake Lively's character, Lily Bloom.
Lily Blossom Bloom. Thank you.
Lily Blossom Bloom. Yes.
Yes.
And a guy named Ryle, because he gets riled up easily. Justin Baldoni, who also directed it. And
Ryle Kincaid.
Yeah.
Just such a romance novel name. I had to say.
I was more focusing on the Ryle part because it feels
Ryle is very good as a name. Yes, very good.
There's a lot of on-the-nose stuff, including a guy named Atlas, who does hold the entire world on his shoulders in terms of all the stuff that's going on here. It's a love triangle, and it is a cheap and cheesy one, and then it becomes about the very serious issue of domestic abuse, and it does so in such a roundabout and indirect way that... that it really doesn't have anything to say about it, except for some really questionable stuff by the end about where the responsibility for it lie and what should be done about it. There's a lot of questionable stuff by the end here, but the most questionable part of it is just that it is a cheap and cheesy and melodramatic romance tale like you would find in a romance novel like this was.
Which it is, yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
So judging on those terms of like a romance novel that gets into very thorny territory that a romance novel likely doesn't usually do, but there's clearly an audience for based on the book being popular and the movie being so popular. I agree that it's not, it's not exactly graceful about the way it addresses domestic violence, but I'd be lying if I didn't admit that I found it to be ultimately affecting by the end, even if I found the execution ham-fisted and my wife, who read the book like in one sitting right before we saw the movie, like the weekend before, she said that like the details that I'm fixated on are not in the book. They're just totally invented movie shit. Like the whole thing about her inviting, like they're together at the end in the scene where she says like the big thing to him, that isn't how it happens. Cause like I found that construction of the scene so unbelievable. Like she hands him, I'm not going to say what, something important, and then tells him this. I'm like, are you out of your mind? Why would the fuck would you do that? And that, like, the details maybe don't work, but I still found myself emotional, like a fucking, like a goddamn mark at the titular line being said. Like, it just, there's something about, like, you can, like, I've never read a romance novel or anything like that, but like I can see the appeal as someone who likes, like, I don't know, Sirkian melodramas or something. Like, I love the idea. I'd like melodrama, and I love feeling I love movies that can make me feel emotional. And I don't know, I appreciate, I didn't mind the like romance novel-y-ness of it. And like the movie's annoyingly like self-aware of the names being bad. Like they keep being like, oh, I'm so embarrassed by my bad name that an author invented, which is very annoying. There's a lot of funny stuff. Like, I think there's one part that made me laugh out loud that no one else laughed at. That was Jenny Slate is working at the store, and there's one customer, a single customer in there. And Blake Lively walks in as that one customer is leaving and goes, wow, busy day. I was like, there's one person there. What the fuck are you talking about? And there was another part where there's a baby, and there's a baby being held. And from one shot to the next, I just happened to be looking right at the baby's face. From one shot to the next, it was a wildly different baby in the same scene. So there's like little details. It's not like a very well-made movie, maybe, but like, I think it kind of threads the needle impressively for being like a romance novel that's hot with hot people kissing, and you think it's hot and it's sexy. And also, maybe not deftly, but it handles the topics of domestic violence in a way that I have qualms about. Like the way she sees his behavior versus how the behavior is ultimately revealed to be, I thought was pretty fucked up. but like, it's the only way that the movie works, I guess, is if you, but then you could excuse it away by saying it's a perspective of abuse, of an abuse, an abusee, someone who's abused, that they would not see it the way that we obviously, anyone outside of the relationship would see it. So like, I was able to excuse that away too by the end. But like, I think the movie is kind of cagey about what it's doing, and it is definitely manipulative in the way that a fucking romance novel would be. So like, it didn't bother me by the end. And like, I don't know if I'm 2.5 or 3 on it, but like, it's a movie that I found like, I have like the double meaning of the title. I was like waiting for it to be like, who's it going to be? This movie does have multiple endings, I'll say that. I think it could have beautifully ended on that last line, on the titular line, but then they have to give her the second happy ending or whatever. But again, that feels all part and parcel. I feel like they don't make movies like this anymore. And it worked for me despite a lot of issues with it. Like, there's some power to the like ending the cycle of abuse narrative that is so like, it's a fucking trope for sure. I'm not arguing it's not a trope that's not done better in several other movies, but like, I don't know. I got caught up in it, I guess, is what you'd say. Like, I got caught up in it. I was laughing at first about the flashbacks to her homeless lover, but like, then it's sincere enough that it works. And it's a kind of a clunky structure. But I don't know, man. It made me feel something at the end, and that's what it was supposed to trying to do. So I have to give some sort of nod to it, right?
I guess. I mean, it made me feel something too, but it was mostly like annoyance. So I don't give it much credit. I do think the idea of perspective is interesting.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. I said you don't like Blake Lively's lip bite acting. There's a lot of lip biting.
She's fine. She's fine. There are bigger problems with the movie than the performances. I do think the idea of the perspective is intriguing. I don't think it really pays off in the way that you're suggesting. I think it is just sort of keeping things at a distance instead of saying this is the perspective of, you know, someone who has been abused and is trying to justify it in her head. That's an interesting idea if it carried through on it, but it doesn't. Instead, it's the clunky during that opening flirtation. It stuck out like a sore thumb. All the other dialogue when she says, "I'm an unreliable narrator," like no one says that.
It's cheesy romance bullshit. Yeah, yeah.
So I just thought that was just a cheap device for the movie to use. I think the whole thing is just cheap, and that cheapens what it's trying to say by the end. I really didn't like it.
I totally understand not connecting with it at all, but like, I don't know if it was like just being on a date for the first time in a year or whatever thing, or just being out of the house with my wife enjoying the movie. I think I liked it more than she did, though. Like, she had problems with it that you're talking about, and she had problems with the book. But yeah, I'm just a mark, I guess. And like, as the father,
we're gonna start taking that personally if you keep doing it.
I'm a mark. You're a mark. We're both marks. Mark and Mark podcast. It's like the father of a daughter thing probably is a factor too. There's like, I got emotional at that. Like, I can't even see a baby being born at any point in life without getting emotional. But like, the specifics of it were emotional for me, and I don't know. It works, but it's messy, and I think it's interesting, but I think they make the abuser guy, they give him too much benefit of the doubt.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, it's baked into the thing, though, and if you accept that it's a perspective thing, which they don't really harp on, I guess.
No, it's baked... It doesn't give him credit because of the perspective thing. The perspective thing makes it worse. The perspective thing makes it worse because he is doing what we see at the end, but by distracting us and making us think that entire time that it's just a series of accidents.
I agree. It's fucked up.
Yeah, it is. It's completely. Yeah. But so it gives him way too much credit and too much benefit of the doubt and all that stuff.
Which is why when I thought the ending was going to do what it was going to do, I was like, oh, thank God it pivoted, because it teases it. It sets up a scene where you think like, it's going to go one way before going to another. And I was like, why are you doing that? Like,
and isn't the fact that it is teasing you, is it, it's teasing you with the possibility that it might go in that direction. Doesn't that also just add to that layer of that? I'm just going to keep saying it, just cheapening the entire subject of making you think like, ooh, what is she going to?
Yeah,
she gonna
I guess I forgave it because I'm just like, it's manipulative. Like, these books are whatever, but like, yeah, you're not wrong. I can't argue that. Okay. I did think it. Like, I did go. Yeah. I was like stunned by what I was seeing. I'm like, is she really? And my wife was like, fucking wait a second. Like, no. And I was like, there's no way. Like, I was like actually jonesing in my seat. Like, there's no way that this is where it's ending. And yeah, that scene goes way too far. And it's just completely unbelievable movie reality stuff. But that's okay. Like, this movie, I think it was Sean Burns, a critic I always read, who said, like, I wished it leaned into the anti-reality more. Because anytime it's reality, it's not good. But when it's like romance novel trappings and big swings, it's fine. I don't know, man. I guess I'm 2.5 just to be reasonable and not get you anyone mad at me. But I did tear up at the end of this movie. It did what it was supposed to do. I don't know what to say. I can't believe I felt things at this movie, because it is ham-fisted is the nice way to put it about a lot of the stuff, and arguably problematic. But
arguably
problematic. Yeah. Jenny Slate's great. Love her. It's cool that she's in a movie that's making a lot of money. There's a lot of, look up the controversy if you want to. Justin Baldoni has hired a crisis PR agent because it's gone crazy. It all started, I think, or I don't know if it all started with this, but one of the things I saw that was really funny was red carpet, somebody asking Justin Baldoni about returning for a sequel or something, and him being like, oh no, I think Blake has made clear that she's like ready to direct at this point. Like, she clearly like took over the movie is what seems to have happened. But you know, I wonder what those differences were, like what they were fighting over. And it must have been those thorny domestic violence depictions, and I just wonder who was on what side. And I Don't know if we'll ever know. It's a lot of sources say articles going on right now. But anyway, two and a half for me.
It ends with us. I meant one and a half.
Yes. I meant to make that joke earlier, but I forgot. So I'm glad you did. All right, guys. This was a long one. Thanks for listening. Apple Podcasts, Spotify. If you think I'm talking to you, I am. If you haven't done it, please do it. There's more listeners than there are reviews. So something's fucked up. Someone's not listening. Please do it. Alien Ant Farm. You can use your time in your review to request a song to play at the end. That's not Alien Ant Farm. I'll listen, maybe. I haven't listened yet. But if there's one that feels right, I'm open. All right, bye.
The show starts in one.
Shut up.